Welcome to Community Balance. I'm Suzanne Barnett, your host. Tonight, we are going to have a fascinating show, and I would like to introduce Jim Maley, who is a member of the Fungus Federation of Santa Cruz. Jim, I'm so glad you're here.
It's good being here, Suzanne.
And I just can't believe all your knowledge about mushrooms, and you're going to tell us all about mushrooms. And how did that begin for you?
I think it began, I was watching this old TV show, Kung Fu, and a man was out there in the wild foraging on whatever he could get. So wild food foraging was of interest to me. And then I went on a lecture by the fellow that taught Yoel Gibbons. And he talked about plants that you could eat and mushrooms. And so it's a wild food thing. It's a foraging thing that got to me. And I was working with a gardener one day, and she was also a member of the Fungus Federation. And she said, why don't you go with me on a foray? And the rest is history.
Tell us first, what is a fungi?
You can say fungus or fungi, you know, fungi or fungi. Either one's okay. And it's a kingdom. It's like the plant kingdom or the animal kingdom. It's a separate kingdom. And so it's an entity. It's an organism. It's something that lives, usually underground. And then it fruits. And many of them fruit mushrooms, you know, and that's their sexual reproduction, where they drop the spores on the forest floor, for example. This is actually an edible Amanita. Now, the Amanita is the genus. This is the Amanita's lanii, or the cochora. And it's an edible mushroom. I wouldn't eat it myself, and you shouldn't eat it unless you're very knowledgeable, because it looks a lot like the death cap. There'd be some differences. The color would be a little greener on top. It wouldn't have any serrations around the cap margin. And generally, you don't see as much skin on the top of the mushroom. You might see a little bit.
You know, how can people become educated to the different kinds? I had no idea, for example, Jim, that I've never seen such an array of mushrooms.
Yeah.
So how would you educate people?
Well, the best thing to do is to join a mycological society. And we have one in Santa Cruz called the Fungus Federation of Santa Cruz. If you live closer to San Francisco, it's the San Francisco Mycological Society. In the East Bay, we have BAM, the Bay Area Mycological Society. We have a candy cap mushroom that grows in the area. In fact, the Santa Cruz campus is a good place to get them. And this is a confection. It's a mushroom that actually has a mapley flavor. It looked like butterscotch out there. And I didn't have any fresh ones, but I have a can of it. You could smell this. And it actually has an aroma of kind of a mapley aroma. It has a very strong aroma.
Oh, it does.
Yeah.
It does. That doesn't look too attractive, though.
It doesn't look attractive, but they make cookies, cakes, and my favorite is candy cap mushroom gelato.
Really?
Oh, it's good. It's really good.
So what if a person doesn't like to eat mushrooms? How could you change that person's palate?
Well, you don't have to. You know.
No, but
I'll tell you one way to do it. My wife is a person, she's a texture person. And so if I give her a mushroom dish with big chunks of mushrooms, she doesn't like it. So I grind up those mushrooms fine, and then she's very happy with it. So that's one way. Some people are just fungal phobic. They're never going to eat mushrooms. They're afraid of them. And of course, everybody has different tastes. But there's some people that eat mushrooms for medicinal purposes. This is a turkey tail, and it's kind of hard, but you can grind it up and put it in tea, or you can chew on it, and it has medicinal qualities. And they're usually good for the immune system.
Well, it's make sure
that's
that,
a turkey tail.
But would you have to go to a certain area in order to find this type of mushroom?
Santa Cruz Mountains. That's pretty common around here, and there's others that are medicinal, and there's some that really don't grow on the West Coast, but you can cultivate them. And the maitake and the shiitake is not found in the wild here in North America, but it's extremely healthful, and that's one you can get in the store. And I can grow them. I know how to grow them.
How do you grow? Tell.
Well, we grow them in bags, and you know,
in bags.
Yeah, plastic bags full of oak sawdust, shavings, and we get the mycelium and we put it in the spawn, and we make sure.
What is the mycelium?
Well, that is the fungi.
Oh, okay.
The entity is the fungi under the ground, and when it fruits, that's the mushroom. That's the sexual reproduction, and it's just like you have an apple tree, and the fruit of that tree is an apple. Well, mm-hmm. The fruit of the fungi is the mushroom.
It's so fascinating.
Yeah.
You must tell us about these other mushrooms, okay?
Well,
how about this big one right here?
Oh, this big one?
Yeah.
Well, I just picked this yesterday.
Oh, my goodness.
This is the queen bolete, and it's a... We have two of them, actually. This is the king, and this is the queen. Notice the queen is bigger. But yeah. They're both very related. They both have the same taste. And in Italy, you would call these the porcini. If you're in France, you'd call it the seps. If you're in Germany, you'd call it the steinpilz. And it's all over the world. And there's very few people that dislike this mushroom. It's very tasty.
What does it taste like?
It's a sweet, mellow taste. And it's subtle but strong, and it flavors your food. It's a very good mushroom, the porcini. And you probably have gone to an Italian restaurant and had them.
I'm sure I have.
And they're all wild.
They're all wild.
They don't cultivate these. You might ask why.
Why?
Certain mushrooms require a mycorrhizal relationship with plants, in this case trees. So the fungi associates with that tree root, and it's a symbiotic relationship. So a porcini like this will grow. A chanterelle, it's another very popular one, mm-hmm. needs an oak tree. So all of these are wild. Nobody really cultivates these because they don't want to have to tend a big forest of trees. Yeah, so it's not very economical to do that.
Now, like with an oak tree, Could this be injurious to the oak tree?
Oh, no. It's a beneficial relationship. The fungi delivers phosphorus and, in some cases, moisture. And the tree or the plant provides moisture and sugars. And so it's a symbiotic relationship.
So it's very healthful.
It's very helpful.
Not only for the person, the human, but for the tree.
Absolutely.
And you must tell us about this one.
Well, this I just picked yesterday, too, in Pacific Grove. This is a cauliflower mushroom, and it grows near a tree. It's always under a tree, but it's not a mycorrhizal mushroom. And this
Tell
one is
again.
Delicious.
Excuse me. Tell us again what a mycorrhizal.
Well, it's, again, a mushroom that the fungi has this symbiotic relationship with the roots of a plant. In many most cases, it's a tree.
Okay. Thank you.
But this one is a very tasty mushroom. The only drawback to this mushroom, it's hard to clean because all these little crevices are, you didn't want to get all the dirt out.
Jim, is it necessary to get all the dirt out?
It isn't really. Some people criticize people for washing their vegetables
That's
and
what
mushrooms
I've heard.
Too much
yes.
because if you're a vegan, you need vitamin B12 and you can get it if you don't wash your mushrooms or your
Does that come
plant.
From the dirt?
It comes from, yeah.
Yeah, the B12.
And so the cow, gets it, and the people that eat meat or drink milk get vitamin B12. So, but, you know, most of the time we want to clean the dirt off. I mean, it's not that tasty.
I believe what you say. Yeah. Now tell us about this one.
Well,
that is just gorgeous.
This was just picked yesterday too. We don't know exactly what this is. It's an agaricus species. We believe it might be the horse mushroom, and it's a very big one. And this is related to the one you find in the store, the agaricus bisporus, the button mushroom, the cremini, the portobello. Well, this is a wild version of that same genus. This is an agaricus, and I'm not ready to say exactly what species yet. But this would be an edible mushroom.
It would be. You know, it's like a sculpture. It's just beautiful.
Yeah, it is beautiful.
But when you look at it, when I look at it, I think, my God, how would I eat this?
Yeah, well, you cook it up just like you would a portobello.
Of course.
But there are two versions of this agaricus that you don't want to eat, and you find them, unfortunately, fairly common, the agaricus californicus and the agaricus xanthodermis. I'm sorry to use the scientific terms, but there's no other name for it. And they have a phenol-type compound. They have a very stinky, like library paste. And it's not considered poisonous, but most people, unfortunately, would vomit if they ate it.
What about this one?
Well, this is a very common mushroom, can be cultivated. This we picked a couple days ago. This is an oyster mushroom. Some people call this the tree oyster. And it's both cultivated and found in the wild. And it's a delicacy. A lot of people, pay good money for these, eight bucks a pound. It's not horribly expensive,
but still,
you can find these in the woods.
And I guess the thing a lot of people don't know is that it does have such value, you know, nutritional value.
Yes.
Practically all of them do they?
Well, all of them have, they're not all medicinal, Suzanne, but they all have protein. Mm-hmm. And Christopher Hobbs, in one of his lectures, again, he's the fellow speaking Saturday at the Fungus Fair, and he speaks every year on medicinal mushrooms. He made a statement that a shiitake mushroom delivers three times the amount of protein if it's cooked versus eating it raw. So we cook our mushrooms, and they do provide protein and vitamins, and then some mushrooms like the shiitake, the maitake, the turkey tail, and those type of mushrooms actually are believed to help the immune system. So they're medicinal, in addition to other qualities, the vitamins and the protein.
Now let's talk about when you go hunting for mushrooms. What equipment is necessary?
Well, a basket or a bucket, something to hold the mushroom, carry your mushrooms with. You really don't need a lot. I think you need a knife. It can be a nice knife, a big knife, or it could even be a knife that you would get at the local fast food restaurant, a plastic knife.
Yeah.
You could even use that. That's all you need to start with. Now, I use a lot of other stuff. I use wax paper baggies. We don't use plastic baggies because the mushroom will deteriorate. I carry those. I have a new GPS system that I've never used yet to avoid getting lost, because that's something you can do in the woods. You're not on a trail all the time. You're off the trails. Mm-hmm. So you have to kind of pay attention. And sometimes if you're not paying attention because you see all these mushrooms, you get lost. And I hate to admit it, I've done it a few times, and you wonder if you're going to get back to the car. And we use walkie-talkies to talk to each other.
Yeah.
Police whistles, okay, can you hear the whistle? That's where the car is. And we bring a lot of stuff, maps and I even have a field guide that I can bring sometimes, especially if I'm in strange territory.
And what is a field guide?
Well, it's a little book that you can actually look up the mushrooms.
I think just in hearing about a mushroom, trying to find mushrooms, you really should not go alone.
That's what my wife says. And so usually I go with a group or a couple people. But sometimes, if I can't get anybody to go with, I'll go on alone. And sometimes I get turned around
So what do you do? I mean, you're here, obviously, you find your way out. But
there's different things you do. With my GPS, it's never going to happen again, Suzanne.
Yes,
but
yeah.
I've been known to, sit there and listen for the ocean. I know where the ocean's to the west. Mm-hmm. And sometimes in certain places, you can hear it if you're really still. Or you try to remember where you got off the dirt road to go into the woods, and there's different ways, and maybe you'll run up against another forager. Mm-hmm. You say, "Hey, I want to find my car. Where's the parking lot?"
Okay, so say you have a whole basket full of mushrooms.
Mm-hmm.
How long will they keep in the refrigerator?
I would possibly keep it a week, nice and cold, but it's better to preserve that mushroom if you're not going to eat it right away, and there's several ways to do that. You can cut them up and dry them.
Oh, most you can mushrooms, dry them?
Most mushrooms can be dried and then reconstituted. And
could you explain that a little bit? How
sure.
would you dry them?
Well, I cut them up and put them in my dryer. And I use it for different things. And
your dryer? What kind of dryer?
It's a dehydrator.
Oh, okay.
And it after about a day and a half, you've got nice dried mushrooms, and then you can put them in a jar like this and preserve them that way, and they reconstitute. Now, there's certain mushrooms. There's very few that you can't dry. This is one of them. The shiitake, well, you can dry it, but when you reconstitute it, this is not a shiitake, it's chanterelle. It tastes like shoe leather.
Oh, dear.
So you really wouldn't want to dry them.
No.
But
no.
Most of them are quite good dried. And then I take a chanterelle, for example. I will wash up, no matter what Emeril Lagasse and all the gourmet guy, you got to get the dirt off. I mean, people will complain. Mm-hmm. And you get that dirt off, you cut them up, and I like to cook them for about a minute or two in a hot frying pan, and then let it cool, and then I'll freeze them. Some people cut them up and put them in the microwave and then freeze them. Or some people just saute them and then put them in the refrigerator, and maybe I put a little lemon juice on them, and then they'll stay pretty good in the refrigerator for a week or two. Week or two in some cases.
Well, that's good information. We're towards the end of the show, so I have a couple of questions.
Yeah.
How many varieties of mushrooms are there in the world?
You're killing me.
I mean, it's
a large, large
really?
Number, and they keep finding new ones. I couldn't possibly answer that question.
Like thousands?
Oh, many thousands.
Really?
There's just a lot of different varieties, and there's variations of a given genus, and they're constantly discovering new variations. And with DNA, they're now associating one mushroom with another, and they keep changing the scientific name. It drives a person crazy. You say, you got to have a good memory, and the older we get, well, you know what I'm saying, and it's hard to remember, and then you learn the scientific name, and it's changing. But eventually, it'll be stable, I think.
What advice would you give to a person, say like myself, mm-hmm. about becoming interested in finding mushrooms?
Well, I would definitely associate with somebody who knows. You need a teacher who knows, a guide who knows. And they don't have to belong to a mycological society, but that's a good way to meet people that know. And the Fungus Federation of Santa Cruz, the San Francisco Society, Bay Area Mycological Society are good places to go.
And it's a social thing too, isn't it?
Oh, yes it is.
I mean, at least you're with other people that enjoy the same activities.
Absolutely.
And the same
and
eating.
It's
them.
Good exercise, mm-hmm. and they have campouts and they have forays where you get together afterwards and you cook up what you found, and it's a real gourmet deal.
It has been such a pleasure to interview mm-hmm. you.
Oh.
And
I'm
impressed with your ability to, bring all these wonderful mushrooms and do uh-huh. what you've done. Really, I just think it's great, and it certainly keeps your mind active.
It sure does.
Remembering all those names.
Yeah.
Really. So happy mushrooming.
Okay.
Well, and I hope you have a wonderful turnout for the Fungus Fair in Santa Cruz.
Yep.
And that's coming up in about a month.
Every second weekend of January.
Do they cook mushrooms at the fair?
They sure do. That's one of the most popular parts of the fair would be the culinary demonstrations. And each day they have one, and the chef will teach you how to cook a certain dish with mushrooms. And then the nice part at the end, they pass out all the food. But they definitely have that, and then we have vendors that create exotic mushroom dishes, and some of the best mushroom lasagna that I've ever had is at the Fungus Fair.
Thank you. Okay. I want to thank our audience for watching, and indeed, we have a superb crew, and may they start mushrooming it up. And I want to thank our audience for watching, and I can't wait to see you next time. Bye-bye.